you know, there's a mentality there. It's a locker room mentality. Yeah, right? It's pretty regular.
Yeah.
You can't take that into running a business and dealing with clients. I have to filter some things.
Welcome to the SeizeYourBusiness.com podcast and video blog. My name is Kevin O'Flaherty from O'Flaherty Law, joined by my co-host Bryan McDonald from onPurpose Growth. And our guest today is John Terry from Jadestone Home Inspections. And we're going to talk about maintaining a strong referral network. So, John, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks for coming in, man.
Thanks.
So tell us quickly what you do. Give us your background a little bit.
Background is I'm a contractor, Chicago, union carpenter, and left the union to go non-union. And with some partners and some really good installers and builders. And then I decided to stop relying on painkillers to get through the day and slinging product, which is sort of the price you pay for being a contractor, especially if you're really involved in it. You know, you're going to hurt yourself at some point. And decided, okay, I'm going to go back to school and study. So when I'm right around 40 years old, I had to go back and start studying again. Oh, wow. So that I could properly learn how to get people into a new home.
Okay, and you're a home inspector these days.
Yep.
Okay, so when I've talked to you in the past, I get the sense that almost your entire business is built off of referrals and that you're really into maintaining that referral network in a strong way. You start, dive in and tell me a little
Very
bit about
Very much
it.
So. In fact, I take a lot of pride in it. As I mentioned before, it's not something that comes easy. There's some sacrifice and there's a lot of risk that comes in. There's always been a formula for starting a business, and it really didn't include doing things that you didn't get paid for. Mm-hmm. You had to somehow show equity, some sort of return for it, and in a short period. I had to take a different approach, or I chose to take a different approach, meaning build a reputation, stick to it, even when it costs you money, be late on your mortgage once in a while, which is scary, mm-hmm. things like that, you know. And now the fruits of that are starting to come to fruition. And I've done it once before with a previous business. We decided that it was take care of your clients, like you say you're going to, even when they don't notice it, look out for your client. It feels good, you can sleep easy at night. Secondly, was take care of your guys. Mm-hmm. Which is what we didn't see in the union that we really wanted, and we knew we could if we can get out of those restraints. So we took care of the guys, then worried about the business. It takes a little longer to build a business that way.
Yeah,
that's the exact same. My parents had a dental practice, and the things they taught me were basically take care of your employees and your customers, and everything else will come from that.
Where was that?
That was on Ogden and Downers. It was Ogden and Belmont.
Is that right?
Yeah, but
so they were ahead of the trend then.
Yeah, well, you know, I think customers, you know, this thing I struggle with is everybody says they've got the best customer service, and everybody says they really care about their customer. But what were some of the things that you did to differentiate yourself and your customer care and the way you took care of your employees too, that people can apply? You know, because everyone wants to provide good service.
That's a good question, Kevin, because I think one of them is one of the hardest. It's owning up to your mistakes. And we are in a culture that we're very afraid to own up to mistakes because there's so much loss involved. There's so much risk to own up to mistakes. We see it in law all the time, obviously. Mm-hmm. Business everywhere. It's very scary to own up to a mistake. But like anything else, once you've had the experience of doing it and that feeling that you get from it, you think, well, wait a minute, this is better than trying to get out of doing something. And that guilt that sinks in, unless you're one of those lucky people that just have no guilty conscience.
Yeah, right.
I've met them. I'm in awe. I'm like, it's amazing. It must be amazing. But I'm not one of them people. So once you experience actually putting yourself out because you said you would and actually care about the client, it's worth way more money than a few $100 that you would have lost on something. And in my industry, that's about it. I mean, when mm-hmm. you're building, it's thousands. But you're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars when you're building. So if you lose a couple thousand dollars because you made a mistake, you didn't put the tarp over before a rainstorm while you're putting on, you know, while you're putting in the trusses, all right, so fix the problem. You could hide. People often hide behind their agreements and contracts. Well, that's not my responsibility. I didn't have to do that. That's a lot of hiding. That's mm-hmm. a lot of backpedaling. And that is one more client that isn't going to be referring you to somebody else. You want somebody to refer you, look out for them, take care of them, make sure that they had a great experience when it's done. You want them thinking you are the best contractor they've ever met in their life. They can't wait to tell somebody that, and as soon as they hear something come up in a conversation, oh, well, we're thinking about doing an addition. They're going to go, oh, do I have a contractor for you? They're excited about it.
Yeah.
Not, well, yeah, we did an addition, but, you know. And then it's just going to go into these negatives because you tried to get out of things and backpedaled. That's not a referral. Referral is one that you put yourself out for the client. And those work. But it's hard to do. It's easy to say. Yeah. Easy to do.
So what do you think the... What is the risk of you not approaching your business this way? What do you see that as?
It's a good question. I guess in my case, it's ending up like other people that I don't respect.
Interesting response.
Yeah, in other words, it's easy to slip into the dark side.
Yeah.
When it comes to needs and, you know, that sort of thing. And I want to move into a bigger house and I want to take more vacations and stuff. So it's easy to slip into that dark side. And rationalize it the whole way. I've seen it happen to good people. And so that's my biggest fear. So
owning up to your mistakes is really, I mean, that's a hard thing for people to do. It's good advice because I've gotten a ton of referrals from people who, you know, maybe as we're growing, something went wrong and my paralegal who wasn't properly trained messed something up. And then I call them on the phone and say, hey, listen, I'm going to start off, I'm going to give you a discount, and, you know, it's a lavish one, and before we even start the conversation, I'm giving you a discount.
Dude, Kevin, I've heard that about you, too.
Oh, have you?
Yes, okay. Yeah.
Well, ideally, I want people to hear he never makes mistakes, but, you know, but down the road, you know, it's going to happen as you grow, and it happens to everybody. So you start off, say, hey, you know, I want to make this right, and then beyond the money, what can I do for you? Here's my apology, how can I make things right? When we were first starting and figuring things out, that was a call I had to make more often than I'd like. You know, as you get better at what you do and, you know, get people that stick around, employees that stick around for a longer time that make less mistakes, you have to start different, you know. Ideally, you want to differentiate yourself in ways other than fixing your mistakes properly, right? So it sounds like, you know, the first couple of years you got to do that. What are some of the things that, like, When you're meeting with a client, you're saying, all right, I know they're going to walk away talking about me because here's why I'm awesome and here's why I provide superior service. It can't be just related to price, I'm sure.
No. In fact, I mean, aside of those who overcharge and abuse the logic of you get what you pay for, often we can apply you get what you pay for. I'm certainly not the cheapest inspector out there. There's guys who are doing it for 30% less than me, for sure, across the board. So it's not price on that aspect anyway. I don't think so, Kevin. When somebody walks away, what they're talking about. In fact, I think the price is forgotten at that point.
What do you mean?
Well, let's look at it this way. So it's a hot day. This is the day that your condenser unit's going to go out when it's 90 degrees. Okay, you want an HVAC contractor who's going to show up that day. Mm-hmm. They're slammed that day because everybody's condenser units are breaking down. You're just hoping that you're
them in the right place in the line. That
right there, that somehow somebody's on their way. You might have company coming over that night. It's 90 degrees, and you got no AC in the house.
That's always the way it happens, right?
That guy shows up, figures out a way, hey, listen, instead of charging $3,500 for a condenser unit, I can fix this thing. It's just a small part. We'll throw it in for $300. We'll get you up and running today. We'll reevaluate the system next year as far as replacement. Did you ever even hear the word $300 except for that it was less than $3,500? All you heard was less than $500 and up and running today. Yep. That's what matters. And he's professional. He knocks it out. He's gone. You got cold air coming through. You don't care if it was $300, $600, doesn't matter. All you know is that your biggest problem has now been taken care of.
Yep.
That's what's important at that point, I think. And so when somebody walks away from me and if I think they're gonna be talking about me, it's gonna be because it was obvious that I actually care about what they're getting into and what's going on with them. And I'm definitely not the most professional. I'm way honest. I'll come right out and say things. I try to filter a little bit to be professional, but for the most part, I chit-chat a lot. So
I think people prefer down to earth. I mean, I found that too. That's what when I was doing a lot of initial consultations, that's what set me apart. It wasn't how many big words I used or how I showed off my education. It was how I could talk like a regular person and not, you know.
Right on. Let me tell you, I have to meet with other home inspectors, especially guys that mentored me, taught me, that sort of thing. They like to show you how much they know.
Yeah.
Because in our industry, you got to know a lot. And a different scale than law, but you actually have to know 7 trades.
Right.
So there's a lot of knowledge. We're constantly in classes. We're constantly studying. And these guys love to whip it out. How much they know about this. And sometimes it's just too much. You know, stop, man. It's okay. You don't have to show off every time how much you know. Nobody cares about that.
Yeah, people want information transmitted as efficiently to them in a way that they understand as possible. You know, tell me what I need to know.
Tell me what I need to know.
Yeah, right.
That's right. Yeah, which I'm sure you experience on a regular basis.
Well, absolutely. If I talk about law for more than, you know, if I'm talking for more than a minute, then I see the eyes start glazing over.
Really?
So I need to gather information from them and then, you know, have a conversation. It can't be a monologue.
So do you feel that your competition in the industry just tells people what they want to hear? They're not honest?
No, actually, that's a good question, too. I don't think that they're not honest.
Well, you said something about honesty and you linked it to not being professional. I would challenge that. I would say that's more professional than the next. So that's kind of where I'm.
Interesting.
What I'm trying to get at. That right?
Well, yeah. If we want to go into a business ethic discussion on it, yeah, I would agree 100%. It's just that it seems that the less you say, the less you. What's the term? The legal term? The less you say something wrong, they can get you in trouble.
Yeah, you're opening yourself to liability sometimes.
Liability. So often it'll be, well, I didn't say that. And I talk a lot, so there's a good chance that whatever I'm being accused of, I said it. It's a good chance.
Yeah, so maybe it's the difference between honesty and dishonesty and really more having a reserved nature and a filter where you're, you know, guarding your words.
I have to work at it regularly. I do. I wasn't born for this industry. I have had to work at it. Certain training to do, certain professionalism to do. You know, I worked with a crew for years of guys all day. You know, there's a mentality there. It's a locker room mentality. Right? It's pretty regular.
Yeah.
You can't take that into running a business and dealing with clients. I have to filter some things.
Yeah.
You know.
I've got one last question for you, John. You said we talked a lot about taking care of the customer, but you also mentioned taking care of the employee. And that can't be all about pay the same way taking care of the customer can't be all about your rates. What goes in, what are the top one or two things that you do to let your employees know that you care about them?
Currently, I don't have any. No. But my partner, when I left the business that I had, and he's still doing well, the way we saw it and we agreed about it was when they need us, we're there for them. Family.
Yeah.
Like family. We didn't just hire guys because we needed bodies. There had to be a connection because we knew we were going to care about them. We're going to make it personal. So when things got hard, or maybe they made a mistake that you would normally have to fire somebody, we'd maybe say, "Nah, man, we're gonna give you another chance," you know, because you gotta put food on the table, you got a baby on the way, you got a wife. That stuff became more important in taking care of somebody than because they've been late for a job a couple times. And where we come from, you can't be late. Mm-hmm. But we were a little more lenient on stuff like that because we had an invested relationship in our crew. It was a family.
Yeah.
So I think that's where we looked out for each other. That and my partner, who was actually my boss, when he made a bonus, when he made extra money on a job, he didn't just always put that into the company. He'd be like, "Hey, we're going out for the weekend," or he'd throw a lavish party or buy everyone new tools or say, "Hey, guess what? We got 401k, woo," or something. Yeah. It was share the wealth. If you get a nugget, spread it around. Don't just think about yourself.
Everybody wins.
Yeah. And then people feel good about getting up on a Monday morning to go downtown at 6 a.m. to go unload a truck in the dock.
Yeah, right.
You know? You don't mind because you just took your wife out for a great dinner just because your boss said, "Hey, man, there's $100.
Exactly.
Well, thanks for sharing your wisdom with us today, John.
Yeah.
We'll put your contact info up on our website, but we appreciate your knowledge and your time.
Yeah, anytime.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, good talk.
Good.
Yeah, thanks, Kevin.